Karlsson, Karlsson, världens bästa Karlsson. Karlsson, Karlsson, hoj här kommer Karlsson. Karlsson, Karlsson, ingen faktiskt, ingen annan Karlsson vill jag så bra som mig.
Karlsson, Karlsson, Karlsson scores!
Karlsson,
Yes! Welcome everybody to another episode of the Keeping Karlsson Fantasy Hockey Podcast, the longest running fantasy hockey podcast in the world, hosted by two guys who, in honor of the Succession final season starting tonight, are looking forward to the day when our kids fight over who's going to take over the Keeping Karlsson empire. But in the meantime, I am your host, Elon Dubrovsky. That was a really good joke, and we've got a lot to talk about today, because a lot of people are going into, well, either a lot of people are eliminated from their fantasy hockey playoffs, which is, you know, unfortunate, and I'm sorry, and I'm one of you in one of my leagues. In my other two leagues, I'm looking, I'm going to the finals. But anyways, that's another story. But for some of us, we're going to the finals. We need to really be focused on what's going on right now. Who's hot, who's cold, and Brian and I are going to break it all down for every single team. I already gave up who I'm with. It is my regular, very great co-host, very good friend, the fantasy hockey robot, the poop-out prognostication, the IPP MVP himself, Brian Kahn. Brian, how's it going?
Elon, I'm good. I'm still alive in the cupful consolation bracket. I have to win the bracket to stay in tier three. I need to finish seventh overall to not slip further down to tier four. And I'm headed to the finals. My team saved all their good stuff for the end of the season, which is not what I really wanted. I have a couple guys who I'm sure we might get to on the show tonight, but like Clayton Keller, holy cannoli. That guy, we'll talk more about him later. So I'm doing okay. My fantasy team, honestly, this is the best stretch they've had all year for the Cupful. Anyway, so I'm feeling good. I'm also pretty pumped. Like, I'm watching our Cupful finals, the Keeping Karlsson Ultimate Patron Fantasy League, kkupfl.com. You can actually see from kkupfl.com/standings, you can click on the Tier 1 Sweden and follow along in the battle to become the world's next ultimate fantasy hockey champion, to take over the crown from you, Elon. Your reign is unfortunately over, but we've got a couple great battles going on right now. It looks like, well, actually, they were great battles through the week. The battle is over in one of those. We've got Ryan, who had the most total points in all of the Cupful, like all 400 and some teams last year. So he got the free pass from tier 6 to tier 1, and he pulled off an upset against the 2-seed Jordan, thanks to like huge weeks from JT Miller, Matthew Tkachuk, Alex Tuck, Dylan Ferguson, Joel Hoffer, like got on the board with a couple new goalies and did well for him. So he's headed to the finals. His opponent is yet to be determined, but we are seeing the makings of another upset happening here with Harrison, that 6-seed, is in charge right now against Mark, and they only have a few games left apiece. And Mark's guys are going to really need to step up. He's got Zaka, Velarde, Nylander, Burns, Lankinen, and Mrazek still going against Barrett Hayton, who's already played, Boris Tkachuk, Seth Jones, and Joseph Woll. But right now, Harrison, last I checked, Harrison was up by 24 fantasy points. And like that's a size. This would be a huge upset. Like, Marcus only lost 6 times all season. He had an amazing showing. He was a finalist against you last year in Tier 1. So he was the odds-on favorite. And I don't know. We'll see how it plays out. I'll give an update by the end of the show. But I am excited. That's my entertainment right now, actually. I've been watching this a little more intently than, like, any hockey standings. But speaking of hockey standings, Elon, we're going to pay some attention to them on the show tonight.
Yeah, so like I was saying, we just need to kind of go through every team. I want to just go through like who's hot and who's cold in each team, because like I said on Matchup Maximizer yesterday, check it out, by the way, subscribe to Keeping Karlsson to get that show where I looked at next week's schedule. But the kind of the TLDR is like every team plays either 3 or 4 times. There's no like crazy busy days aside from Saturday. Like it's not like I think that like there's a reason you could take a player from any team. Like it's not like there's teams you have to avoid. Like even the Tuesday, Thursday, Saturday teams, you probably can fit the people in on Tuesday, Thursday. So that's 2 games in 4 days. It's not so bad. So if there's a player that we talk about that you may find interesting, I think you can like feel free to consider adding that player. So I think it's important to just go through each team, cover who's hot, who's cold. We've got the amazing Frozen Tools, which has a list for us of just for every team. It's amazing, like automatically generated. So I always use this site to prep the show anyways. And I figured like this one, we'll just kind of go through it. And yeah, we'll go in the order of the standings here because then we could also kind of keep track of which teams are the best, which sometimes is bad, actually, as we're learning with Boston right now. So Brian, I guess let's get right into it. And yeah, Boston is the top team in the league, and with that privilege gives them the opportunity to rest some of their older, you know, aging players to get them ready for the playoffs. And that is bad news for anyone who is depending on Bergeron, Marchand, or Lindholm to, here you are. Some people are in their semifinals fighting for it. They needed those games. Boom, they all sat, and for different reasons, like Bergeron's under the weather, and he was progressively worse during Saturday's game. That's the update from Montgomery. And he also has a nagging injury, as do Marchand and Lindholm. So I wouldn't be surprised if these guys maybe sit a little bit if they have nagging injuries. Like Boston has nothing to play for now. So I think that's the main story here. Here's three players we know. But as we go down the standings, especially these teams that have clinched and they're just starting to rest and get ready, you have to be very careful in the meantime. I mean, I don't know, like Tyler Bertuzzi's on the top line with Krejci and Pastrnak, who, by the way, Pastrnak just scored his 50th and 51st goals of the season. He's having an insane season. So, that's bad for DeBrusk and Zaka. But who knows like what the lines are going to look like in the next game. So you may be able to stream in some Boston guys that normally aren't that interesting to you. But you're going to have to check GameDayTweets.com every single game to see who's playing and who's not, and who's potentially like playing with a Pastrnak if Pastrnak's not sitting himself.
Yeah, you are going to want to know who's playing with Pastrnak, basically. And I think that's it. I'm looking at the box score for the game so far today, and the scores are, well, you've got Pastrnak with Charlie McAvoy, who I think is worth following up on here. You know, last week he asked if we could drop him, and I was like, I'd be hesitant to, and I think I was wrong, Elon. He has now, like, the Bruins-Canes game is now in overtime as we're recording this. He has not taken a shot, Charlie McAvoy, for three games now. And he's taken 10 minutes in penalties, which is like bizarre. You have to go back like 2 months before this to find a combined 10 minutes in penalties that McAvoy's taken. So he's not shooting. He's taking penalties, which like would also maybe indicate he's down a step. But if the Bruins are sitting their other guys, and you'd think they would go ahead and sit Charlie McAvoy too to get rested as well. He does have two assists tonight. Maybe that's, I'm burying the lead here, including one on the power play. He's back on the top power play tonight after having been off it, as we were talking about, for the last 2 weeks. So maybe there's some comfort. Like maybe if he was dropped, now's the time where you can go and grab him for next week, assuming he plays. But you're going to want to keep refreshing, yeah, GameDayTweets.com to see if McAvoy is in or out of the lineup. And then I think you really just want whoever's playing with David Pastrnak, who has scored two of Boston's goals tonight. The other one was scored by Jakub Lauko, who's a 22-year-old rookie from Czechia. And this is, he scored his fourth goal of the season. He's played 18 games this year, so not a whole lot to say about him. He doesn't play a whole lot, rarely plays even 10 minutes a night. So when he dresses, he's still basically scratched.
Okay, well, good info on Jakub Lauko. Yeah, I think it's pretty wild that we're at the point now where it's like, yeah, McAvoy is good if Lindholm is scratched, is sitting for injury, because that's his only chance of getting the top power play. Who would have thought we would be saying this at the start of the season? But yeah, I guess if Lindholm's going to be out there, maybe that's an opportunity, because also I'm seeing here that Dmitry Orlov is listed as one of the cold players on Boston, and yeah, only 1 point in his last five games. So after that awesome start, he does have an assist today, but before that he was cold for a bit. So yeah, it's really been Hampus Lindholm. Like, he's the real story. Unfortunately, he's injured, but while he's been healthy, he's been doing really, really well. But that's the Boston story. And then, of course, Ullmark and Swayman, as we've covered, just, you know, going back and forth every single game. So that's probably not going to change. That's going to be the one thing that's going to be super easy to predict moving forward, I think, is that Boston goalie rotation. Okay, Brian, next up, we have the Carolina Hurricanes, who, like you said, are playing Boston, and they're also second in NHL standings. Who knew? They have 102 points in 71 games.
I knew. I think a lot of people knew. You think that's surprising?
I thought there were some other teams that were maybe better, but no.
Okay.
All right. Carolina's a good team. And, you know, maybe they didn't do too much at the trade deadline, but maybe they're happy with who they have. They have Shane Gostisbehere, who, by the way, was super cold, but has started to get going at least a little bit. An assist today, also an assist like earlier in the week. So obviously not that like crazy like 4-point game that he had earlier on, but it is nice to see Gostisbehere. Yeah, two assists in two games in a row. So maybe there will be some value there if you want to stream in a Hurricane. On Frozen Tools here, Carolina is listing no players as hot right now, but three players who are cold. And this is obviously not including today's game. Brady Shea is listed as cold, and I guess he saw that and took offense because he did score a goal today in this game versus Boston. I'm just gonna throw it out there, Brian. I know you always don't like it, but I'm still into Brady Shea. He's still taking a lot of shots. I think if you need D going into next week, you could do worse, and he's probably available in a lot of leagues.
For sure. His shots are still there, which we talked about last week, right? Even though the offense has dried up, the shots are still there. He did have a stretch about 10 days ago where Shea had 3 goals on 7 shots. Without that, he'd really, he'd only have the shots on goal going for him in any recent moment. But yeah, he had a bit of shooting luck a little while ago, and that helped. But yeah, for as good as the Canes are, there isn't a ton of fantasy value. And also, no one has really stepped up in Svechnikov's absence, right? Like, it was, okay, who's going to be good? And Kotkaniemi has had a couple moments here and there, but he still barely shoots. And if he points, it's just an assist. You know, in the Kakupful, assists are worth less than goals, so they're a little less exciting. But yeah, you've got Nechas, who is up to 7 points in 8 games, including an assist today. And outside that, it's a really quiet time. Teuvo Teravainen has been ice cold for a while again. And I don't know what, you know, like, we were waiting for him to get started up. We said if he's on the top power play, he's going to be okay. Well, he's been there, and he is without a power play point for the last 12 games. He's gone without one. And tonight is that 12th game without a power play point for Teuvo Teravainen. So he's somebody who's been, I think, really hard to roster and hang on to. You might want to give him another shot. You know, he might be still the best chance you can take in your free agent pool, but there really aren't a lot of great Carolina Hurricanes fantasy options. Like, you know, the middle and bottom of their lineups don't offer either. So it's basically, I don't know, Elon, you've got Nechas, you've got Aho, you've got Brent Burns. Is anybody else on Carolina like a must-have player?
Well, you know, just to go back quickly to what I was saying about Shane Gostisbehere, because you bring up Brent Burns, I'm seeing today that Gostisbehere is getting more power play time. It's Gostisbehere quarterbacking the top unit with the cold to Ervine, and like you said, Aho, Natchez, and Stefan Nason. So it does seem like they're not like splitting, you know, 50-50 power plays here. It's a clear PP1, and Gostisbehere is there, which means maybe even Brent Burns is someone you're a little bit concerned about. But of course, that could just be like tinkering, and we'll see what happens. But yeah, I'm with you though, like that Teravainen is cold, but that doesn't mean like drop him for sure. Like, Carolina plays 4 times next week. He scored in the last game. He's in a good, like, he's playing with Aho, he's on the top power play, and he's a good player. So I feel like there's, you know, obviously he's not like the insane producer that he used to be all of a sudden. I don't know exactly what has changed, but he's in the best spot we can expect him to be in. So you don't want to just completely ignore him.
Yeah, just monitor for snoozing, I think, is my warning on Teravainen. Like, don't take for granted that he's scoring, because he's not. And it's been a good, like, he had a hat trick back on March 5th. But outside that, it's been like 6 weeks since Teravainen has been producing with any kind of regular impact.
Yeah, agreed. Okay, so next up we go to the New Jersey Devils. I wonder how many East teams we're going to get here in this like top 10. It's a lot. But New Jersey just clinched the playoffs with their win over the Sens yesterday. In net, Mackenzie Blackwood. He's back again. He's like the new like Ronta or Matt Murray, like just like never can stay healthy. But he finally did get back into the net for the game against Ottawa. Did okay, right? 28 shots against, stopped 25. Well, it's a sub 900 save percentage, but hey, got the win. And I guess the organization liked what they saw enough to send Akira Schmid back to Utica. So the Devils are going to ride with Vanecek and Mackenzie Blackwood until Blackwood's next injury. And we know that Vanecek has been a little cold recently, like we discussed. So who knows? Maybe it's going to be more of a back-to-back thing. Very hard to predict. But yeah, don't just be rushing and grabbing Vanecek or assuming Vanecek's going to be getting all the games. I could see it going back and forth, just like it was going with Schmid. Right, it's very hard to predict the New Jersey goalie situation right now.
Yeah, I feel like the goalies in New Jersey have basically been reset to the start of the year. Vanecek continues to be up and down and inconsistent, and Schmid, you know, seemed like maybe, I don't know, I feel like there is a universe where he is the best option of the three, but of course, you know, for contracts and also what the organization believes. Schmid was not one of the goalies who made the team out of camp. So they'll have an open competition, I feel like, over the rest of the season between Vanacek and Blackwood. And I agree with you, Elon. I could absolutely see them trading starts until, you know, the last few games before the playoffs. They really want to see if they can get one guy rolling. Maybe someone will get a run, or they'll just keep alternating and they'll follow that into the playoffs. So I think the message here, the actionable advice, is that if you have Vitek Vanacek, continue to expect less volume than you were able to get from him for a large part of the season. And if Mackenzie Blackwood is out there, he could make a good spot start, especially if your league values wins.
Yeah. And as far as the skaters go on New Jersey, I mean, Jack Hughes just had two games in a row where he scored two goals and one goal. So he's up to now 40 goals. So his first ever 40 goal season. Congrats to Jack Hughes. And obviously still going. He's amazing. Tons of shots also. They talked about on Short Shifts this past week how Mercer has jumped onto the top power play instead of Jesper Bratt, and that held for that game against Ottawa. And I believe, yes, Mercer did score a goal, which broke a bit of a cold stretch for him. I believe, yeah, it was Shams and Jeremy, and one of them said that maybe this is an idea to get Mercer going, or maybe it's just a handedness thing. But either way, it's a good spot for him. So if he's available in your league, because he was cold for a while, Dawson Mercer in a really good spot right now, playing on this line with Heischer and Timo Meier, and then also on the top power play. Speaking of Timo Meier, Brian, we had a question from Ryan, a patron in our Discord. We, of course, always like ask the patrons to let us know if there's any player in particular they want to talk about on the show. One of the perks of supporting us. And yeah, Ryan was basically saying that he's really disappointed in what he's seen from Timo Meier since he came to New Jersey. Like, he was hoping that he could continue what he was doing in San Jose. And obviously, it's not like a situation where he's going to like drop him now, but he's in a keeper league. And he's saying that maybe he doesn't even want to keep him. Like, he was basically saying he doesn't even know if he wants to keep him this season, let alone, you know, multiple years moving forward, as was the plan. But yeah, now it's two pointless games in a row for Meier. Before that, he was going on a little bit of a run. The thing is, kind of like when we were just talking about Brady Shea, I look at the shots on goal column and it looks really healthy. So it's like unfortunate that he's maybe a little bit snake bitten, as I guess you're going to cover. But I personally wouldn't be worried. Like, I look at the deployment, I see that he's playing with Heischer and Mercer. I see he's on the top power play, and I see that Meyer's shooting a lot. So got to imagine the floodgates will open sooner or later.
Yeah, I hope so. One thing that Meyer's missing in New Jersey, I think, is being as much of a trigger man on the power play as he was in San Jose. Like, Meyer has 14 power play goals. This season, 13 of those came with San Jose, and now he has just one in 12 games with New Jersey. And part of that is because he is not the default shot taker, although he actually is getting as many shot attempts as I drill down a little bit here. Meyer is taking as many shot attempts per 60 minutes with the Devils. So maybe it's not that he's not the shot taker, but he is getting stopped a lot more often. Those shots are getting blocked. In San Jose, Meyer was attempting 32 shots per 60 minutes and putting 21 on net. And in New Jersey, he's attempting 32 shots per 60 on the power play, and only 14 per 60 are finding their way to net. So that's a pretty big interruption to the number of pucks Meyer's used to putting on net. And the other thing getting in Meyer's way is that at 5-on-5, he's playing about 90 seconds less per night. So that's not helping. And there is some poor variance. Like, he's only been in on 40% of the goals New Jersey scored while he's on the ice. But outside that, he still looks like his regular, dangerous, high-volume shooting self. So I think there's still a lot of reason to believe that Timo Meier has not disappeared, that he actually could nearly replicate, not completely replicate, his San Jose pace because of less ice time. But if he can find a way to get those power play shots through the defensive coverage a little more often, you know, however that New Jersey power play setting up clearly isn't working for him the same way it did in San Jose, then that'll work for him. And yeah, he'll lose a few points by virtue of not being on the ice as much. But overall, I still think we're seeing all of the Timo Meier that we want to see. So that's the good news. The bad news is it's not showing up on the score sheet. So my message here is to be patient, Timo Meier managers. And if anything, actually, I'm kind of licking my chops a bit and seeing Timo Meier struggle down the stretch. Like, if he continues to not be able to put up points, I see his draft value falling, and I will still be happy to take him in my drafts next year. Like, maybe I can get like a Dougie Hamilton like discount on him in my draft next year if he doesn't pick it up before the end of the season.
Yeah, I mean, there's also the playoffs, so he's going to have a lot of opportunity to bounce back here. So I feel like, Brian, you're probably not going to get that opportunity, because I agree with you that I think it's just a matter of time.
Yeah, I agree.
Okay, next up, let's go to the fourth-ranked team, and we are going to the Western Conference. We're going to the Vegas Golden Knights, who have 98 points in 73 games. And if we look over on Frozen Tools here, our hot players on Vegas are Jack Eichel, Alex Pietrangelo, and Phil Kessel. What year is this? Phil Kessel is hot right now. I can't imagine that anyone has him on their roster at this point to be enjoying the production. But yeah, 5 points in his last four games for Phil Kessel. He's on a four-game point streak in this last game against Edmonton. Kessel, he had an assist. He took two shots. He had a power play point. In fact, three of these 5 points have been on the power play, which was always kind of a place where Kessel used to feast. But he's not even getting like PP1. So I don't know. This is kind of a luck thing. How much time, Brian, are we going to spend talking about Phil Kessel here?
Not anymore. I am going to just shout out his line mates, though. Chandler Stephenson and Nicolas Roy are both going along with Phil Kessel. They're going along for Phil Kessel. I mean, Stephenson, not so much. He's still just a point every other game, but he did have 5 shots against Calgary the other night and followed that up with none against Edmonton on Saturday. So that's a bit of a bummer. But Nicolas Roy is floating to the top of my like recent average over 14 days because he's only played twice since February 21st. And he was actually hot when he got injured. He had 4 points in 5 games. This is a third liner in Vegas, and he's come back from injury with 2 goals in 2 games and had 7 shots against Edmonton on Saturday. So if you're someone holding Chandler Stephenson, who I doubt you are, but if you are, I would swap him out for Roy, who I don't expect to see a whole lot more production from. However, he did play on the top power play unit with Eichel, Stephenson, and Barbashev for a good chunk of the last game. And we should also shout out, maybe you were probably going to get here anyway, Ilan, but Pavel Dorofeyev. Has this 22-year-old caught your eye yet?
Oh yeah, I have it in the notes here, Brian. It's like, who's this guy? He's on a hot streak. He's looking good. I guess to give the specific numbers here. So what have we got here? Dorofeyev, I guess is probably how it's pronounced. Pavel Dorofeyev. So he's playing on a line with Michael Amadio and William Karlsson. So, you know, maybe not the best spot, but you have 4 points in his last 4 games. Like 3 of them are goals. And, you know, he's not taking too many shots, but two or three shots per game. You're not going to expect like to score a goal every game doing that. But it's better than someone who's like scoring on just 1 shot. Who is this guy? Who is Pavel Dorofeyev? And is he someone? Because, you know, sometimes happens. He's only played 10 games this whole season. The first three, he did nothing, and then he got sent to the minors or something, and now he's only come back on March 12th. So since then, we're looking at 7 points in 7 games. So a really nice introduction here to the season for Dorofeyev, who also played 2 games I'm seeing last year, but new to the league. Maybe there's something here.
Yeah, he made the move from Russia. He's 22 years old. He was drafted in the 3rd round, 79th overall in the 2019 draft by Vegas. And Vegas brought him over to North America in the 2021 season. The 2020-2021 season. Oh, it's so hard to talk about those years. He had a modest debut with the Henderson Silver Knights. And the following season, though, in 21-22, Dorofeyev was amazing. 27 goals, 25 assists for 52 points in 63 games in the minors in his first full North American season. This season, it had looked like for Henderson that Dorofeyev had taken a step back to 17 points in 32 games, which is a pretty substantial drop from the pace he was on last year. However, he has come up and done quite well in 10 games with the Golden Knights so far. Like you said, Elon, he's scoring on 22% of his shots. He's taken 2.5 shots per game, which is good, but not a lot. And if that shooting percentage does regress, then we can't expect a whole lot more from him. But he is seeing some opportunities, and those opportunities seem to be increasing. He played a few games initially, then sat out a bit. But on this most recent call-up, he's performing. And this is somebody who I think the Golden Knights are invested in and would be happy to see perform. So we'll see how much opportunity they give to him down the stretch and how they make him a part of their team going into the playoffs. But it seems like he's there to stay, and there's just another guy on the Vegas roster that you can roster and spot on a night that they're playing.
Yeah. Also, just cool to see Jack Eichel doing his thing. Like 3 points in the last game. Also had a hat trick at the end of last week. So you like your superstars to do something. I'm happy for the people who drafted him to be getting some value out of him in these playoffs. Obviously, the final thing we need to talk about on Vegas is that they just broke a record, Brian. The first team in NHL history to have four different goalies earn wins in four consecutive games. So Yuri Patera, Jonathan Quick, Logan Thompson came in, did enough to get the win, and then got pulled back from injury, but he did get the win in that game. And then in the most recent game, Laurent Brossoit came in and was able to pull off the win himself versus the Edmonton Oilers, which is, you know, no small feat there. It was a 4-3 win for Vegas over Edmonton. So now, obviously, Thompson injured again. I guess we'll wait for an update there. And in the meantime, it'll be Brossoit and Jonathan Quick. I don't know. I feel like that's another 50-50 situation, probably. Really hard yeah. to predict what's going to happen.
Well, I'm trying to figure it out because I have Brossoit. I picked him up expecting his start before he got injured, had him on IR, was very happy to basically, you know, then you get a free start when he does get healthy, and it came at a pretty good time for me. But now I don't know what to do with Brossoit because the Golden Knights only play three times this week, Tuesday, Thursday, Saturday. And if he doesn't play Tuesday, I don't want him. But I don't know if, like, I have no idea. What do you what would you do, Elon, if you were me? I can hold him till Tuesday, till the goalie start announcement is made. I think they're playing at 10 at night. So if I hold him that long and he's not playing, it's kind of a bummer. But if he is playing, I want him. He's on the fourth ranked team in the league. And if they play a goalie for two consecutive games for the first time in a long time, I want that guy. And he made several big saves on Saturday, too. What would you do? What should I do?
I think I would probably drop him. Like if you drop him now, you could probably even add him back on Tuesday. Like, do you still have moves left from this week?
No, I've used them all.
Oh, okay. Well, I don't know. It kind of depends what you're going to get. Like, you know, like you're holding him till Tuesday, and then if he doesn't play, then you have to drop him for someone. But like, what's the opportunity? You know, like, is there someone that's playing Monday, Tuesday that you'll fit both their games? That's like a more sure thing. Maybe just go with that rather than risk it. So I think that's probably the way that I would go. Like Montreal plays Monday, Tuesday. I've been eyeing Kirby Dach as someone that's available in a couple of my leagues.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Recently returned from injury. Well, to Montreal, okay. I'm looking forward. Like, I'm glad they're at the bottom of the standings because we're saving some of the best for last.
Yeah. By the way, speaking of saving the best for last, everyone, I hope you're going to stick around with us for this next, we still have like a good hour and 40 minutes of content coming your way as we continue to go through all of the teams in the league. But first, I think we got to take our first commercial break. So stay tuned. We'll be back soon to talk about the New York Rangers. You're listening to Keep It Carlson. All right, sirs and madams, we are back. And Brian, it is time to continue down our list as he scoffs and just rolls his eyes at me. Try to say something a little different once in a while. I don't know, I can't say the same words every single time. You get our AI to just replace me if that's going to be the case. But anyway, we're going to the New York Rangers next. Great season for them. Right? Like, we still haven't talked about Toronto and Tampa, who everyone was talking about how, like, wow, like, so unfair that those two teams are just forced to play each other, even though they're two of the best teams. Like, all of a sudden, now we've talked about New Jersey, Carolina, Rangers. I know there's other complaints about, like, oh, but we knew that Toronto was going to play Tampa. That's why it's annoying. Anyway, I just think it's interesting that they've kind of both not gotten into this top five here. But the Rangers are there, 96 points in 73 games now. And on New York, if we look at Frozen Tools here, at their hot and cold players, Igor Shesterkin hot against. He was cold for a little while. Obviously wasn't going to last forever. Adam Fox. We haven't really talked about Adam Fox too much. I feel like there's been other defensemen who've caught our eye, and Adam Fox is just kind of doing what we expected him to do. But we should still say that that's, like, very good. He has 65 points in 73 games, a 73-point pace. Last season, he had, obviously, his career high, 74 points in the Norris-winning season. I wonder if he catches it. I guess it's going to be, like, a close race. He has 65 right now, so he needs 9 more points. But either way, I don't even have a question for you about Adam Fox. He's very good.
Oh, okay. Well, I thought you were going to ask me if he could keep it up.
Can he?
And I'm just... Yeah, he probably can. Like, he's basically doing exactly what he did last year, which is super impressive. Like, holding exactly, and for that matter, basically also what he did the year before, just in fewer games and a little less deployment. But yeah, Adam Fox has been fantastic. Last year, he produced at a greater rate on the power play than he has this year. And I think there might be room for him to even do a little more than he's done so far this year. Like, the difference I see is he's participated on 60% of the Rangers' power play goals he's been on the ice for versus 75% in the last 2 years. So I could see Adam Fox, you know, that I think that's the difference right now between his current 73-point pace and last year's 78-point pace. And I don't see any reason why he can't just like regress back to that near 80 point pace. And like you said, I think we did once this year, like just stop to recognize what he's doing and then move on. But yeah, he's been amazing, especially on a team that has so many guys to look at, right? You've got, and now even more guys, but you know, you had your Kreider, Zibanejad, Panarin, a lot of guys you just expect are clicking, but one guy who's not, I don't know if you've noticed, Elon, he's probably got a big fat snowflake next to his name, Chris Kreider, going invisible for the last few games. It's a crucial week, and he's done this regularly for about, I don't know, like, I'm looking at his game log, going back to December? He's like scored for a stretch of games and then disappeared for a few games in a row, scored a bunch and then disappeared for another few games. Like there are basically full week long stretches where Chris Kreider is given nothing. And that's happened several times over the course of the season, which is a really frustrating pattern for anyone rostering him. Basically this season, he's back to his usual 57, you know, like high 50s point pace that we've always seen him at. And I'm not sure that I expect much better from him. Like coming into the season, it was like, no, definitely not going to be 80 points again because those 26 power play goals were not scored sustainably. But I thought he could get, you know, to 70 points, but no. And I'm not sure he will. So yeah, bummer of a season from Chris Kreider.
Yeah, though I will say that it really does seem, if you look at his game log, like he goes quiet for 2-3 games and then has like 2 or 3 games in a row of scoring a goal. And he is now pointless in 3 after a previous 3-game goal streak.
So here comes the explosion.
Yes, if you have Kreider and you're still in it, like I think get ready. Okay, strap in. It's about to happen. I mean, he's in such a good spot. Kreider's playing with Tarasenko and Zibanejad, and he's playing on the top power play with, yeah, Panarin, Zibanejad, Patrick Kane, and Adam Fox. Like you can't surround, I guess the thing is he's not like the go-to guy necessarily that he used to be on the power play, like with all those weapons. So maybe that's something, but yeah, I mean, I think he'll go off next week. Just following the pattern.
And like, to be fair, like there's been an overcorrection. Like last year, he shot 40% on the power play. When over his career, he's been like in the 20 to 25% range. This year, he's shooting just 10% on the power play. And he's no less dangerous than he was last year, which was like a huge upgrade for him on the power play. Like his chances were through the roof dangerous. His threat level, expected goals, super high, career high. And he has kept that up this year. But the variance has not just regressed, but swung the other way. So I still believe like Chris Kreider could be in like that 65 point range, but it would be nice to see a little consistency because like, yeah, he might win you for every week he wins you over the last few months. He might have lost you as well, which is a frustrating way to produce.
Yeah. Well, hopefully the peripherals, like the shots and the hits, like at least like keep you afloat in those weeks where he's not getting points. Another guy who's cold, he's got another snowflake beside him over here on Frozen Tools, Vincent Trocheck, pointless in 3. And just like Kreider, before these 3 games, Trocheck was on an amazing run where he had assists in 5 straight games, with 3 of them being multi-assist games. But yeah, all of a sudden, Trocheck is ice cold. I don't love his lack of power play time. I mentioned that top power play, and Trocheck is not there. So all these guys coming in, someone had to lose out. And lately it has been Trocheck who's having to play with the kids, having to hang out with Hedl and Lafreniere on the second power play. And Jacob Trouba, well, he's not a kid. So, you know, I'm not as confident in Trocheck bouncing back as I am in Kreider. But who knows what will happen next
week. I would be interested to hear from anybody who could find any players who, like, maybe we should call it the Katy Perry Award. You know, they're hot and they're cold between Kreider and Trocheck, who just, like, have swung back and forth between, like, I'm so glad they're on my team, to this is miserable so many times this season.
Is that the, oh, hot and cold. Okay. Yeah.
You know it. Was I off tune?
It's like,
hot, then you're cold. Yes, then you know you're in, then you're out.
Oh, okay. I have a book for my daughter that's called Opposites. That's a lot like that song, actually. Oh. It's just each page has like, you know, up, down. You know.
Wow.
She's very young. I don't think she understands
yet. That's high-end stuff.
I think that eventually it'll come useful.
I'm just figuring it out.
It's some of them are, you don't know. But okay, we got to keep going here, Brian. So
is vinegar a sauce?
Is vinegar a sauce? Where did that come from?
My 4-year-old asked me that. I was showing her what vinegar is, and she asked, "Is that a sauce?"
I guess so. What's a sauce?
I don't think it's a sauce.
Does a sauce have to have more like thickness to it? I guess. Is that what
I think
thinking?
So. I called it like a condiment, and then like there were also pancakes on the table. And she's like, "Is maple syrup a sauce?"
Well, ketchup is a condiment, and I would say that's a sauce.
Yeah, and ketchup, I don't know if ketchup is a sauce.
Anyway, we don't have time for this, Brian. Let's go to the Toronto Maple Leafs here, okay, who are playing right now. I could actually really use a goal from Nylander to just clinch a matchup for me against Jeremy. He's gone, like, super cold today, which is a little bit frustrating, but right now they're winning 2-1 over Kevin Lankinen and the Nashville Predators with, 7 minutes left. Anyway, the story on Toronto. So first of all, in net, Samsonov left. I think it was like for the birth of a daughter or a son. I don't know why I just assumed daughter because I have a daughter. So I assume that's what everyone has. But anyways, and then also the Leafs have been resting people. They had a night where they rested Morgan Riley last week. So you got to be really, this is another team you got to get a little nervous about in terms of who's going to play. And hopefully no one will burn you. One guy who's definitely not burning his managers when he's playing is Austin Matthews, who is being like the guy who people drafted second overall in their leagues, right? Like he's like, and hopefully I know Lewis is going to be like so angry because he drafted Matthews in tier one of the couple and he didn't make the playoffs. And now he's like scorching in his like consolation playoffs, just like you, Brian. And Matthews is obviously a big part of it. So he's on a crazy point streak. He's got 9 points in his last six games. Maybe even more impressive are his 15 shots he took yesterday against Carolina and he scored on two of them. Like Matthews is amazing. And so it's good for him. It's good for the Leafs, obviously, to see him really getting going. And, you know, when you look at the hot players on Frozen Tools, Marner's, Matthews, and Tavares. So you can't complain if you're a Leafs fan. The players who are supposed to be hot are hot, except for William Nylander, unfortunately, but I'm sure they're not too worried about him. And then it's just a matter of, like, a lot of years, like, is the goaltending going to hold up? I don't know, because, we'll see.
Yeah, Austin Matthews, 8 goals in his last 10 games, including 15 shots against Carolina. Carolina. Yeah, I almost feel like Carolina's like doing a little, I don't know if rope-a-dope is the right, like they're like, okay, you go shoot. We're going to make it easy for you. We're not going to show you how we're going to defend you if we do play each other in the postseason. There's no other explanation. Like Carolina barely gives up 15 shots to entire teams over a game, let alone one player. I mean, he did have over 5 minutes of power play time, Austin Matthews, and that certainly helped. And it also prompted the question in our Discord, in our patrons-only Discord server, who holds the record for most shots in a game? Did you happen to see, Elon?
I don't recall what the answer was, though. I think you mentioned, okay. Didn't someone say like some really old players from like a long time ago?
Yeah, it was Ray Bourque with 19 shots, but I was surprised it was a defenseman. I mean, I guess it's the easiest, like, you're open, right? You have to, the puck needs to get through, but he had 19 shots, and that was the game that Ron Tugnutt set the 70-save record as well while he was playing for the Quebec Nordiques.
Actually, sorry, I was thinking of a different thing that came up on the server of, like, a player from, like, the 50s or something. But, yeah, like, Ray Bourque, I don't mean to insult our, like, you know, somewhat older listeners. I mean, like, oh, so old.
He's not
Ray
that
Bourque.
Old.
Okay, so that's Toronto. And, yeah, let's do another team here before we have to take another break. And next up in the NHL standings, sorted by who's the best in the entire NHL. And we go to the Los Angeles Kings, believe it or not. Like, what a season for the LA Kings. A team that went into the season with Jonathan Quick and Cal Peterson and just were, like, playing well but struggled to get the goaltending. Now, all of a sudden, they have a completely different tandem in Phoenix Copley and Yunus Korpisalo. And both of them have just been scorching. And, again, another, like, very easy to predict, like Boston. They're just taking turns, game in, game out. Korpisalo's played. I saw some stat. It's like he's got like a 950 save percentage in his games with the Kings so far. Like, yeah, they're a very scary team. And today there's going to be some more reinforcements coming in because Kevin Fiala is back in the lineup after missing some time. I mentioned on Matchup Maximizer yesterday how Victor Arvidsson has looked really good and he's been getting top power play time. I'm going to be curious to see if it's Arvidsson who gets bumped from the top power play or if it's Vilardi. I guess we'll find out. This game is actually for the listeners. You're going to know the answer. Just go to Game Day tweets and we have a link to Frozen Tools to get the actual last game lines if there's no tweet about the power plays. But yeah, I think that it's going to be an exciting game today to see what happens with Fiala back in the lineup. Yeah, the Kings are just gearing up. I honestly, Brian, I wouldn't be surprised if they end up coming out of the West, or at least like I still kind of feel like Colorado is the team to beat, even though we haven't talked about them yet. But I know we talked about Vegas, but I think Vegas would be very concerned to play LA at this point because they're just like, yeah, they're winning every game. It's like it's really hard to beat that team.
Yeah, LA is unbeaten in regulation in their last 10, or at least their last 10, actually. I'm just looking at their last 10 games record. 8-0-2. That's a fantastic run that the Kings are on, and all systems go for them. I'm not sure there's really any big insights to have here, except I will shout out Quinton Byfield, who continues to keep rolling. He's got 9 points in his last 11 games and still has those games where like he just gets an assist and like one or no shots. But he also is occasionally taking 3 or 4 shots, which is a nice little trick he added since missing some time due to injury through November and December. But he's been having these, you know, occasional 4-shot games for a couple months now, which was the one thing that we were really concerned about from him, which is that he never really took a shot, which made it hard to roster him on a regular basis. But all these points are still coming for Byfield. And if you're looking for a deep cut, Carl Grundstrom has 5 points in his last 4 games. 4 of those have been goals and they've come on 8 shots. So don't expect this to continue. He's still playing on the third line and has like no really meaningful deployment at 5-on-5 or on the power play. But, you know, when you're hot, you might stay hot. So Carl Grundstrom on a bit of a hot streak.
Yeah, I would even maybe consider his line the fourth line. I don't know. Yeah, that's definitely not going to last. But yeah, I think that like you hit it, Brian, like Byfield's probably available to a lot of people in shallower leagues. Like Arvidsson is probably still available. And I'll just give the numbers here for Arvidsson. 6 points in his last 5 games. Like 4 of them are goals. And it's like coming on games with like 3-4 shots, like every single game consistently getting you those shots. So Arvidsson, who was like dropped in a lot of leagues earlier in the year, I actually picked him up in my couple division. I haven't checked in to see how my team's doing since I've been eliminated, but I'd imagine that he's been helping them do pretty well if he's not like on my bench because I haven't been setting my rosters. Okay, Brian, next up, let's go to the Minnesota Wild, who I've talked a lot about on Short Shifts and on Matchup Maximizer because the Wild are so interesting because Kaprizov went down. You thought it was going to be bad for everyone, but all that happened is Matt Boldy has just totally emerged as a superstar in the league. He's just unstoppable. Since, well, I guess he was stopped versus Chicago yesterday because he didn't get any points. But aside from that, he's been unstoppable. Like he's got now 12 points in his last 8 games, Matt Boldy. I was talking with Shams about it. I think we've gotten to the point now where you're looking for like who you can get that's playing with Boldy. And the name there that might be available to you, and I know this is a rerun for anyone who listened to Matchup Maximizer, but that person is lately Marcus Johansson, who also snuck on. When I was talking to Shams about Johansson, he was still like not on the top power play, but it looks like Ryan Hartman was on PP2 in that game yesterday against Chicago, and Marcus Johansson on the top power play now with Zuccarello, Eriksson Ek, Boldy, and then also on that line with Eriksson Ek and Boldy. So like obviously Boldy's number one and Joel Eriksson Ek is number two, but assuming those guys are taken and you want to get in on some of this fun, I think Marcus Johansson is available in a lot of leagues and someone that is just going to continue producing as long as he's playing with Boldy.
Yeah, agreed. We talked last week about all the production that's coming in Minnesota. So I'll just mention one guy where it's not coming from who's really struggling without Kaprizov, and that's Matt Zuccarello with just a point in his last 5 games. It felt okay because he had 15 shots over 4 games, but now I'm concerned on Saturday night, nothing against Chicago at all, and one of his lowest ice time totals since Kaprizov was injured, although the Wild didn't have too much power play time, so that might have factored into that ice time being so low. But I'm hoping that Zuccarello, like if everyone else is producing, I don't see why Zuccarello can't. So hopefully he can step it up again soon. I wouldn't be cutting bait on him, although it is a big downgrade when Foligno replaces Kirill Kaprizov on your line. And then the other thing I wanted to mention in Minnesota, one thing we were talking about last week was what the goaltending situation was, if Marc-Andre Fleury was about to start taking, you know, several starts in a row, or if they'd keep flipping back because Fleury had been a little more consistent than Gustafsson, and Elon, can you helpfully provide the update on that?
Yeah, well, the update is it's kind of swapped again. Like, they've just been going back and forth, so maybe this is another one of these just reliable tandems moving forward for a bit. But in terms of the results, Fleury has now let in 5, 3, and 4 goals in each of his last 3 games, including most recently letting in 4 goals on 34 shots versus Philly in a loss, actually. So, you know, a game that they should have won and they weren't able to. Meanwhile, Gustafsson has had 2 gems in a row, letting in 1 goal against both New Jersey and then Chicago. I don't even want to like have one of these conversations. Like, oh, is it time that Gustafsson's going to get more? Like, no, it's probably just going to be 50-50, and it'll be interesting to see. I'm curious to see if a team is just going to like go 50-50 even into the playoffs. Like, it's working so well for LA. Like you said, Brian, they're 8-0-2 in their last 10 games. Like, why wouldn't LA just like let it roll and just keep on swapping Copley and Corposalo every game? I don't think I've ever seen that in my life, and I feel like this is like Boston also. It's going so well, just going back and forth. Why not just doing that? If it works now, why doesn't it work then?
Agree.
Yeah, it'll be fun to see. Okay. Brian, okay, let's take another break here, and then we'll finish off part one here. How many teams have we done? Not too many. I guess this is typical for us.
Yeah, we'll pick up the pace on the back half, I think.
Well, we said we're excited about Montreal, so we can't just, like, speed through Montreal, but maybe the other ones. I don't know. Maybe when we get to, like, Chicago, we'll be able to go kind of fast.
That'll be quick.
We'll be back soon. You're listening to Kevin Carlson. Okay, sir, we are back. That, sir, was to you, Brian, by the way. We're going now to the Colorado Avalanche, the team that, yeah, I mean, they're just not fully healthy. So I know they're like not at the top of the standings. I still think they've got to be considered one of the top threats in the playoffs, especially if like Landeskog actually comes back, you know, and everyone is healthy. We did get Evan Rodriguez back in the last game. There was a lot of excitement around Dennis Malgin for a minute when Rodriguez got injured, and then Malgin got on the top line, and Colorado had that great schedule coming up, and Malgin just totally, like, couldn't have gone worse for anyone who jumped on him, and I'm one of them. I think I'll still be okay in that matchup, but it's a little closer than it could be. But yeah, in these last three games since Malgin's 2-goal-1-assist breakout, he had like a game with 3 shots and 3 hits and 2 blocks. I was like, okay, he's not gonna get a point every game. Last two games, like, just like 1 and 0 shot, no points. He's like only 8 minutes and 47 seconds in today's OT win over Arizona. So obviously forget about Dennis Malgin. If you want to know the lines that they ran with today, they had Nichushkin in that sweet spot with McKinnon and Rantanen. So McKinnon and Rantanen stuck together, and it wasn't Evan Rodriguez, and it wasn't Malgin. Now it's Nichushkin, who's already rostered in a bunch of your leagues, which basically kills like all the forward fantasy value. Like, now you're probably not excited. Like, Compher's on the top power play, so he's the other one you want. Rodriguez, but also it might change around. So you gotta get, this is gonna be another one of those teams that you're just gonna want to watch the lines and see if you can catch some fire with someone playing with McKinnon and Rantanen.
Yeah, that's the moral of the story here. Just keep an eye, like, always check the game day tweets for Colorado, see what they were working on in lineups or pregame rushes, and then make a call based on that, because things seem pretty in flux for the Avalanche. That's it. That's all there is to say. You want Compher, and everybody else is a game time or game day decision on whether you want them on your roster.
Yeah, and then I'll just similar to Austin Matthews, someone who was picked super high in drafts and maybe like wasn't living up to his draft value is Cale Makar, who was like only like a point per game ish defenseman for a lot of the season, which is still like really good, but obviously you wanted a lot more if you were taking him like 5th overall. Well, Makar has just exploded lately. We're up to now 19 points in his last 10 games, and even went pointless today against Arizona. Before that, he had like 2 straight 3-point games. He was injured for a couple of games, and that was great news for Bowen Byram getting on the top power play, but Makar is back, and he is, you know, trying to make his claim once again that he's the clear top defenseman, and it's not even close. So it'll be fun to see drafts next year if he still goes as high, or if maybe people will be a little bit more wary, since a lot of the season he was just like awesome but not like extremely awesome, if that's a fair way to put it.
It's hard to believe that he'll go quite as high in drafts next year as he did this year, but I still think he's probably a first round legitimate pick. We'll see what happens in the playoffs. But yeah, I still like a lot of what I see from Makar. Maybe instead of being on the front end of the first round, he'll just move to the back end and, you know, past the between the 10th and 14th overall mark rather than the 2nd to 6th overall mark that I think he was drafted in a lot of leagues.
Okay. When you said overall mark, I heard all mark in there. And I started thinking about the Boston goalie. This is how my brain is like.
I would definitely draft Makar over all mark.
Okay. So let's go now to the Dallas Stars, who, Brian, like, tell me if this is bad. Maybe you'll say you're not surprised either. I'm kind of surprised also to be talking about Dallas so early into the show. I didn't realize they were like this great, but yeah, they've had obviously a really good season. They're now at 92 points. So they're going to easily cruise into the playoffs here on the back of course, like the players who we expected, right? This isn't the surprise. The top line, Miro Heiskanen, Jake Ettinger. That's been all it's took for them to go far. And really, there haven't been too many other standouts, of course, except for Jamie Benn, who's been on the top power play and has just been cruising. But like, I look on Frozen Tools, I see Heiskanen, Robertson, and Pavelski are the hots. And Nils Lundqvist, Ty DeLandria, and Max Domi are the colds. I guess Max Domi was someone we did consider could maybe be good. Like, obviously not. Forget him. I talked about Max Domi a little bit with Shams on Thursday when we were talking about Sagan coming back. Sagan, not too exciting. I don't know. I don't think there's really a reason to talk about Heiskanen, Robertson, or Pavelski. So I'm good to move on from Dallas. Like, good for them. There's just nothing new ever to talk about with this team.
Yeah, maybe I'll just mention that Heiskanen, you know, we mentioned Adam Fox being a 73-point player and how great that is. Miro Heiskanen, 73-point player as well. And I think he's been someone who's really benefited from more offense at 5-on-5 this year for Dallas. And honestly, I don't see too many reasons to expect any less from him next year. Like, Heiskanen is here. Like, this is he's almost doubling his the same season-long pace that he's put up over the last three seasons, and I don't expect him to go back. So Miro Heiskanen, I think, is absolutely in that top-end elite Adam Fox-tier D conversation for next year.
Okay, next up we go to another team where I feel like there's nothing really to talk about in the Edmonton Oilers, where, yeah, if you look at the hot and cold players here on Frozen Tools, Connor McDavid, Leon Draisaitl, and Ryan Nugent-Hopkins. What do you know? Those are our hot players. I guess, like, should we talk about Evander Kane as someone who maybe isn't
yes.
doing as well as people were hoping? And yeah. there was some concern about maybe, you know, when he came back from his injury, that could be bad for Hyman. Like, I don't think so. Like, Hyman's still been on the top power play. Kane, I'm seeing in the last couple of games, barely any power play time at all. He's taking only two shots a game. He's still getting his hits, but yeah, he had that hat trick against Seattle last week. Aside from that, he's been pretty disappointing since returning from his injury. Is it like drop do you get, like, let's say you're in a league where hits aren't worth that much, like a cupful, you know, it's not like as if like the hits are carrying you, like in a categories league, and you're just like hoping for shots and points. If you're in a shallow enough league, is it time to like considering to cut bait on Evander Kane, or is he like kind of like too good to let go of?
Cutting bait would be hard because, like, the upside is absolutely there. However, the upside seems lower since Kane has returned from his injury. As you mentioned, Elon, like, he's hitting, but he's not shooting the way he was. And that concerns me. Like, so he's a 11 or 12% shooter. But if he's only taking, you know, two and a half shots per game, that's a goal every four games, which, like, isn't what you're looking for from Evander Kane. Like, before the injury, he was producing at a higher rate than that. Last year, Kane in Edmonton had a goal every other game on average. So you're basically seeing that rate cut in half, plus no power play time. This hurts. And we had actually a question on our Patrons Only Discord server from someone saying, like, I need a back-to-back player to start next week. Should it be, I can choose between Evander Kane. I have Evander Kane, but should I drop him for Michael Matheson or Raphael Harvey-Pinard? And I was like, no, like Evander Kane. And then like I took a minute, I'm like, you know what? Yes, drop Evander Kane and I would take Michael Matheson, spoiling a bit of our Montreal talk, ahead of him. Just because, without that power play deployment back and without the shooting coming back, I am down on Kane. I'm worried. I'm worried he's not up to total capacity, and that makes me a little nervous going forward. I wouldn't want to be relying on him.
By the way, I'm just going to give a personal thanks to Leon Draisaitl for being so amazing. I have him in my Dynasty League. He was my first pick. First overall, I remember being scoffed at the time because I should have taken McDavid. At the time, I thought to myself, he has winger eligibility and he takes face-offs. As he counts face-offs. Also, his salary is a lot less.
I was still like a bad, like, do you think with the salary savings, he is worth more than McDavid to you?
Well, he also is taking a lot more face-offs, which is like very useful. But I don't know. Mm-hmm. The way McDavid is this year, maybe not. But anyways, this is ancient history and I won last year and I'm winning in the finals this year. So I'm not going to second guess myself too much. But I will say that Forrest's game against Arizona, just so beautiful. Just seeing and all those power play points. Oh, he's so good. Like,
speaking of power play points, sorry to interrupt your dry style. Way to go, Leon. Send him a letter. Send him some flowers. You know what I think people are taking for granted? Is Evan Bouchard just producing now that Tyson Barrie's not there? He's got 10 points in his last 10 games. Four of those have come on the power play for Evan Bouchard. But the last two games, he's seen 97 and 93% share of Edmonton's power play time, which is added up to about 8 minutes total. That's amazing. Like, this guy has gotten into a place where he can produce. If you added him out, if you were the fastest finger to add him out of free agency, congratulations, you're in good shape. And Elon, I'll also just toss out with the back-to-back coming up somebody, I'm sure you talked about him on Matchup Maximizer, but Kyler Yamamoto, who's been, you know, a little off and on lately, but a little more on than off and on for a little longer. Like, usually we're like, oh yeah, he's good for a game and then forget him. But Yamamoto's on a bit of a run here. 4 points in his last four games. He had three consecutive games where he took three shots. He's still not seeing any power play time, but I did add him for my Cupful Consolation Finals, and I'm hoping he can do at least something while playing alongside McDavid.
So there is something I was about to bring up that hopefully won't be too much of a bummer for you, Brian, but just looking at last game lines for Edmonton, Yamamoto started on the line with McDavid and Evander Kane, but it looks like there was an equal amount of time where Matthias Janmark took that spot and Yamamoto played with Fogel and Nick Bjugstad. So I don't know when you made that ad. But if that holds, I guess we'll wait and see the line combos in the next practice. But obviously that would make Yamamoto absolutely worthless. So hopefully that doesn't hold for you. But if it does hold, then Matisse Janmark. But also I don't want to like advise people to grab Matisse Janmark because it's just going to change again. But I guess it's like part of our job as podcasters is we have to tell you who's playing with McDavid.
This is the situation. Know it. And yeah, I'll be refreshing lines around the time of the Oilers morning skate at game day tweets.
Yeah, I guess in hindsight, I kind of blew it. Like I kept Bouchard as a keeper in our like keeper league together. And then he was so bad at the start of the year. And eventually I traded him for Teuvo Teravainen because I was going to drop him anyways. And then, you know, I didn't feel bad about it. Even when Teravainen was cold, it was like Bouchard was colder. Now, all of a sudden, I'm realizing, I guess I should have been patient with Evan Bouchard. So,
I mean, no one knew.
Like, but I mean, I guess a lot of people knew.
Who knew?
Like, I mean, people knew that Bouchard was like their future power play quarterback. Like, that was the planned guy. So
right.
Maybe, like,
but there was like a keeper limit in the league you were keeping him in. What is it? 3 years, 4 years? And it was basically almost the length of Tyson Barrie's contract. So why would you suffer through that?
Well, I appreciate
like
that.
It's a great lotto ticket to take. But that was, I think, one of the bigger blindsides we've had in recent memory with Tyson Barrie getting dealt.
Yeah. Well, they really wanted to get Matisse Ekholm.
Not to speak of Matthew Tkachuk and Jonathan Huberdeau. That was a massive one, but this was a real, real quiet one. And usually, like, the Edmonton media, like, murders somebody on their way out the door. Nary a word said about Tyson Barrie leading up to the deadline.
Yeah, and when we get to Tyson Barrie, we'll talk about how he's really hot right now. And we did say, I think, on the last show that Barrie, like, was cold, but was like, or maybe this was on short shifts, that, like, with Roman Josi injured, you might as well just hold on. And, yeah, Barry's been producing. But we'll get there in a bit. But still, let's continue in order here, okay? So after Edmonton, we've got the Tampa Bay Lightning, and Tampa Bay is just kind of cruising along here. The hot players, according to Frozen Tools, are Stamkos and Mikhail Sergachev, who are probably not available to you. Maybe, like, the guy I'll talk about here is someone, you know, we always talk about on and off, like, throughout these podcasts, but right now it's Alex Killorn, who's been on the top power play. I grabbed him a couple weeks back, actually, in this keeper league where I'm still fighting in the playoffs, and he's just been, like, really reliable. Like, I don't know. I like him. So if he's available to you, like, while he's on the top power play, I like Alex Killorn, but I guess it's nothing new, so I don't really have much else to say. I guess, like, we should probably talk about the fact that it's been Mikhail Sergachev on the top power play, but again, it just feels like such a rerun to talk about that, because it happens, sometimes it changes, but now it's happening, Sergachev is doing great, but obviously we're not going to tell people to drop Victor Hedman, and he still scored a goal recently, so, you know, I don't know, Brian, I got nothing here for Tampa.
Okay, I'll follow up on Brandon Hagel, who we were talking about Killorn or Hagel on the last episode, and we saw, I can't remember if I think we leaned Killorn because Hagel hadn't been playing on the top line. He, as of the most recent game, Hagel was playing with Point and Kucherov, still not, of course, on the top power play unit, but still pointless in four for Hagel. He's got 9 shots over those 4 games, which is okay, but not great. And he's not hitting a ton either. So yeah, Killorn over Hagel. Killorn, like you said, reliable. He's not going to get too exciting for you, but nice old reliable player you can just plug into the lineup.
Okay, yeah. Next up, let's go to the Seattle Kraken. Look at them cracking the top half here. Oh, Kraken. I didn't even mean to make that pun. But yeah, it looks like they're going to be playoff bound, and it's going to be a lot of fun to see what they can do. If you look at their hot and cold players, one thing that jumps out here that I know we've talked about a bit, but Jared McCann is someone who I got out of free agency early on in the season in the Cupful, and I think I even dropped him at one point and then added him back. And McCann is like having himself a year. Like, at this point, I saw a stat that he's, like, leading the league. Let me get this exactly. It was, like, or like among the top in the league in even strength goals. Like,
I think it was goals or goals per 60 minutes? Right,
I'm going to GameDayTweets.com right now, a tweet from Allison Lucan, one of our favorites. Jared McCann now has the 5th most even strength goals in the NHL this season. So that's very good. Top 5.
Yeah. One of the reasons he's doing that is he's not taking any more shots than he has in the past, and they're not any more dangerous. And his ice time is actually exactly the same as it's been for the last 5 years. So nothing really super new here for McCann at 5-on-5, except his 23% shooting percentage, which is too high. Last year, he shot 15% with Seattle, which was twice his general, almost twice as general. Like, up until that point, McCann had been like a 9% shooter. So jumping to 15% last year was like, okay, that's a bit of a jump. Maybe we'll see some regression. And this year he's jumped again on top of that. So I don't know that I'm going to expect this Jared McCann even strength goal scoring to continue. But he's been super valuable to anybody who got him early and has been riding this wave of what I think is a lot of variance. But his power play and 5-on-5 production overall has been solid too. So I think he'll still, like, he still could be rosterable without this high shooting percentage, but he would probably fall back in line with the sort of vein, the way we paint all Kraken players, which is like good for a while and then quiet and hard to roster.
Except for Vince Dunn, we have to say, because he's just,
oh my gosh,
incredible.
Vince freaking Dunn.
He's good. Though yeah. I will say also, regarding McCann, obviously your numbers are for the full season. You look at that game log lately, this is looking like a superstar, right? Like, you look at these shots on goal column, like there's an 8-shot game, a couple 4-shot games. Like, this is the type of guy you expect to have a 40-goal season. If he could keep this up for like all of next season, I think he can do it again. Yeah, the beginning of the year, definitely there were a lot of 1- and 2-shot games, and he just happened to be scoring yeah. a goal on one shot, a goal on 2 shots. That hasn't been the case lately. So I think second half McCann, if that's for real, then I think he is more likely to be able to repeat this.
That is a good point, Elon. I think he's still scoring a little much, but yeah, like maybe not a 70-point pace, if he can keep the shot totals higher, but close to 70 points. Yeah, he'll be a fun guy to watch. Well, okay. Maybe we'll dig in a little more in the offseason.
Yeah, because also you got to assume that Matty Beniers is could like, you know, take a big step forward as he gets more experience. So maybe there could be some big times ahead for a few of these Kraken guys. But yeah, obviously Vince Dunn is the hottest. Did I cover who's here? So McCann, Dunn, and Daniel Sprong is the other hot player. Sprong like did this before, like running hot, and then he like totally disappeared. But he's now got goals in 3 straight games and more of like the more like likely to be unsustainable shot and goal numbers with only like 2 or 3 shots in each of those games. And also he sometimes gets healthy scratched. But if you're in a super deep league and you want to add, like, Daniel Sprong is someone who knows how to score goals. He has 19 goals this year in 56 games, so not too shabby at all.
Yeah, to his credit, even when he's only shooting, like, even when he's not shooting a lot and he's on, like, 3 goals on his last 8 shots, but Sprong has actually pretty decent expected goals numbers since coming to Seattle and actually for some of his time in Washington, too. So, yeah, he deserves to have a reasonably good shooting percentage. Like, he's shooting 16% right now. That seems not unreasonable given the threat level of his shots, but of course he doesn't play a whole lot, which means he doesn't shoot a ton.
All right, Brian, so we've made it through 13 teams out of 32, which is what, like 35%? Not great. Okay, but we're doing the best we can here, but it is time to end part one of the episode. And then I guess, you know what? If these other teams wanted more airtime, they should have done better. They should have ranked higher in the league, and then we would have talked about them. I definitely have a lot of players that I definitely will make sure we're going to want to focus on, because we are looking at who we want to be streaming in for next week for people going for those championships. So yeah, just if you're listening to this, you're excited to hear what comes next. I hope it'll be good. By the time you're listening to this, that will have already been recorded. And, you know, check our Twitter. We'll let you know if it turned out to be bad and we don't think you should listen to it. But if you don't see any tweet saying don't listen to part two, then assume that it's going to be really good. And so make sure you're subscribed to Keeping Carlson. Go download part two and hope you like it. And yeah, if you're subscribed, by the way, to the podcast feed, not only do you always have part two waiting after you finish part one, but you also have Matchup Maximizer. We're going to have a couple more short shifts this week, as per usual. Like, we're just rolling along with all this content, taking you all the way to the end of your fantasy season. And we're going to also go into the off season. It's gonna be great. Okay, so stick around, we'll be back soon. Thanks for listening. See you in part two.